I'll make a short presentation before we start the discussion on technology for profitability. So if you look at the overall ecosystem in the transportation industry, we have clients, then we have transport companies, then there are intermediaries like agents and brokers, and then we have the large transport companies, of course, some of them have owned assets, otherwise they could be also having attached fleet. And then we have almost 90% of the total number of vehicles which is there on the road today, about 4 million trucks will be there. So out of that, 90% will be small truck owners, which basically 5 to 10 truck owners, we call them small truck. So they will comprise of the last ecosystem. Now the total size of the pie is about, I think, broadly estimated at $100 billion, and the entire valuation is shared between all the players. So if we have to do anything good for the drivers, for transport companies, for the manufacturers, the profits has to be generated by this system. So the discussion will be focusing on how do we improve the profitability for the fleet operators. See, if we look at the profitability of fleet operators, the the segment is extremely cyclical. So there are periods of high stress when we see the industry making losses, and then there are periods when the industry make more money. The larger transport companies, there are a very wide range. The operating margin ranges between 4 to 14%, and that depends on the nature of business. Some companies will have a very high asset intensity, so the margins typically would be higher. Then there are companies with low asset intensity, mostly depending on attached fleet or acquiring fleet from the market. Then also the nature of business, like the validation in terms of express segment or GTA. Express cargo players obviously have higher realization and have make more money. Share of contractual business, again, that gives the amount of visibility, revenue visibility one can have. Typically, larger MNCs will give higher contractual businesses. The revenue visibility will be higher, but at the same time, most of them could be negotiating for very fine margins. The broking segment, typically the commission is about 2 to 5%. There the profits are relatively more stable. However, with so many new technology players, especially the aggregators coming into the market, business of these brokers also could get challenged. Then finally, we have the small fleet operators where the profitability, we have a very highly variable cost structure. 60% of the cost is on, the largest component is on diesel cost. Of course, the profitability also depends on the overall asset utilization and the freight rates where the fleet operators have no control, and also the overall trend in diesel prices. Just to highlight, in the last 2 years, while the economy has been doing quite well, still the industry profitability has been highly fluctuating and quite challenging. During the periods when diesel price had remained low, typically the freight rates had remained stable over the period and the profitability had been good. But at the same time, in the last two, three quarters when diesel price started moving up, most of the fleet operators were unable to pass on the cost increases. So as a result, the profitability shrunk, and in many cases, they were either operating at break-even or maybe in a very tight situation. So effectively, that also brings in, highlights the importance of use of technology to focus on how do you improve the profitability of the fleet operators.
Use of big data and route and network planning and efficient asset utilization. See, one of the things which can be used is telematics. Now, a lot of the transport companies have started using telematics, especially the larger operators have started using telematics, and gradually we believe the usage of telematics will significantly increase. And as we look at this, effectively, this can improve in terms of reducing fuel cost by effectively tracking the fuel efficiency and the driver behavior pattern. It can also lower cost of servicing by monitoring the component failures and looking at even making product adjustments. Also, it can significantly improve the overall connectivity and monitoring of the fleets. Of course, the challenges also would be that most of the drivers would not be liking 24/7 monitoring. So to that extent, there is a fine balance between how do you ensure that monitoring, which is good for from your fleet owner's perspective or from the customer's perspective, and also how do you provide the necessary privacy which or the freedom which the driver wants to enjoy. Also, the use of technology can significantly improve the vehicle safety, and also can closely monitor the driver behavior. In this slide, we are talking about some of the aggregators and the, what kind of role they are playing in kind of changing the industry. We have looked at some of the new technology startups. They have been trying to, they are trying to help the small players kind of aggregate and achieve scale and take get advantages of some of the scale, some of the advantages which scale can bring in. We have seen small players have been able to get a discounted price on diesel, negotiate a better price on diesel using some of these platforms. They are also, some of them are able to generate better working capital borrowing rates. Because if you are able to provide your operations data more transparently, if you can ensure that kind of data to the banking system, then the unorganized players can move into the organized segment and enjoy better credit rating or better credit profile or better interest rates. Also, the availability of financing can improve significantly with availability of data. Also, I think some of the new players are also helping these smaller operators acquire these telematic sensor or other technology software at a lower cost by aggregating the demand. So overall, I think the aggregators are playing two critical roles. One, to improve the overall asset utilization for smaller players, and also to bring in the scale advantages, which typically traditionally only the large transport operators are enjoying, to bring in the scale advantage to smaller fleet operators. This is just a breakup of the overall cost structure. If we look at some of the areas where there are scope for improving the cost, for example, better monitoring of the vehicle, preventive maintenance can reduce idle time and also improve asset utilization. Similarly, there are vehicles which will be carrying sensitive goods requiring certain maintenance of certain temperature. So closer monitoring not only ensures the perishability of the product, the product survives, also gives better confidence, especially most of the larger MNCs would require for their products to have this kind of telematic controls. Also, partnership among aggregators can lead to lowering of insurance cost and borrowing cost. The other things that can be reduced is installing fuel sensors, which can reduce pilferage, but at the same time that also impinges into the existing freedom which the drivers enjoy. So one has to be sensitive about that also. Route optimization is something which is very important, and we have already seen in various segments panning out. Also, smaller players are able to get access to fuel cards, which allow a discounted access to fuel prices. Looking at the challenges, some of the challenges to faster adoption of technology. One is, of course, poor infrastructure. So for some of the technologies, the infrastructure challenges are not so limiting, but for higher end technologies, the lack of charging stations or poor connectivity of internet could be a challenge. Similarly, lack of skilled manpower, already it's been highlighted in the previous session, lack of drivers, but at the same time, the lack of education among drivers could be challenging unless the technology is very user-friendly. And similarly, acceptance of technology by drivers, also even the small fleet owners. So one needs to demonstrate the kind of advantage, the profitability or advantage one can derive from this kind of technology. And the entire ecosystem has to benefit from this. Otherwise, the acceptance of technology would be very slow. The other roadblocks could be in terms of regulatory issues. For example, traditionally, the wait time at toll centers have been very high. So these things can significantly dilute the advantage of use of technology. With the implementation of GST, there has been improvement in this. But in the future, probably there is further scope for simplification of the documentation, because if the documentation across the country and across product categories can be simplified and maybe made uniform, then one can use technology better and can ensure faster movement of goods. With this, I conclude my presentation, and we'll start the panel discussion.
I think I'll start with Siddharth, if you can give a brief introduction, because your company is relatively new and operating in this new startup space. So if you can explain what are the kind of things which you are actually trying to do in the industry, and then maybe you can take it forward further.
For us to be new, I think we are almost 3.5 years old now in the space. Now, what exactly we're trying to do is something solving the problem which we are sharing, which is technology for profitability of fleet owners. So when we say or talk about fleet owners, we're primarily talking about small and medium-sized fleet owner. Yeah. That represents 74% of your fleet ownership in India. And largely, whenever we say that, hey, Indian trucking is unorganized, we are primarily talking about small and medium-sized fleet owner, where you call the DCOs, the driver cum owners, or small fleet owners who are owning one or two trucks, which is where the real problem or the crux of the problem lies in India, is that how these people are managing their fleet. In the previous sessions, we had three sessions, there was one discussion happening that the financier is not too sure of financing the small or individual fleet owners because he's very doubtful about the profitability of the truck or whether he will turn NPA. Then we had a discussion about driver availability, which is scarcity of a problem. Now, third, where people were discussing about, hey, what about the future? There is a driver scarcity. We are not sure if we are to finance small or individual fleet owners for them to operate trucks. So if you put the entire set of problems together, you would find that there is something problem lying in the business side of it for small and medium-sized fleet owners, right? Which is where required to be solved in. And one of the key problem there is their ability to utilize their asset. So when we see Indian space, all the small and medium-sized fleet owner, to our estimate, are not able to use their asset more than 70%. So the asset utilization is as low as 70%. Most of the time, the asset is lying idle, where they are not able to locate their return loads. They are not able to find loads to keep their uptime and keep their profitability high. One of the key areas where why that this problem of NPAs or defaults do come up is of their ability to locate business. How we see or what we are bringing as a solution is, and I think maybe a few of the panelists earlier were to say that maybe they have stopped saying it. We, in the evolution of trucking in India, we saw the era of trucks being sold on commitment of services, trucks being sold on the commitment of warranties, truck being sold on the commitment of AMCs. Take my word, wait for 2 years or maybe 2.5 years. A truck in India will be sold on the commitment of guaranteed business. We call it truck with loaded business, right? That's what the future is. Wait for 3 years at max. Few of the OEMs are definitely gonna come up in India with the concept that, hey, this is a truck, you are a driver, become an entrepreneur, there is an installed business in it. Buy a truck with loaded business. That's what we stand for. That's what we wish to create as far as future of trucking in India is considered. And I largely believe that all the problem areas we have been discussing since bonding, which is about driver availability, profitability, its dignity. You make a driver become an entrepreneur and make him decide his own life. Trust me, he will get his dignity back. He is an entrepreneur at the end of it, and he's driving his own life, his own conditions. That's one problem, that's one kind of a solution which the day OEM adopts, giving commitment of business as installed in a truck when they sell it, solves a majority of the problems. That's what we are trying to create.
I'll jump to Mr. Suresh. Now, while we are talking about fleet operators, I think one very most important player, of course, is the OEM. Finally, he provides the equipment. And one of the most challenging part for fleet owners is the price which he has to pay upfront for buying a vehicle. And with regulatory tightening of regulatory norms, safety norms, last 4 or 5 years, we have seen the cost is going up exponentially. And then coming April 2020, we have implementation of BS6, which is going to lead to significant jump in the cost. Expectedly, that cost will go up significantly. Now, Siddharth highlighted the fact that the capacity utilization in the industry traditionally has remained low. But one of the reasons why it has been low is because of the huge cyclicality. And whenever there is a cost increase, the ecosystem, the fleet owners or the truck, small truck owners or even the large fleet operators, they are not confident about the profitability or the profit cycle for next 3 to 5 years. So as a result, whenever there is any significant benchmark comes up, whether it's implementation of BS4, BS6, we see a huge amount of pre-buying. That only shows the kind of uncertainty which people have in their mind about whether they can afford to pay a significant high price for the vehicle. So how does the manufacturers or the component suppliers try to address the cost of ownership? Because this is something has gone up very significantly in the past, and if you have to add driver comfort to that, so the requirement from the investments is going to go up very, very significantly.
At the outset, let me thank you for giving me this opportunity here. Actually, I come from ZF, and we are a component manufacturer, have been in the commercial vehicle industry for more than 100 years now, and in India for almost a couple of decades. When the first supply chain was put in, actually I come way before that. I supply components to the OEMs, who in turn supply the vehicles to the market. And it's when Nabil talked about this topic, for me it was very critical, because when I go and pitch in front of the purchaser of any of the OEMs, I always talk about total cost of ownership. And that's where the technology comes in. My strong belief is investment in technology is a mindset. We need to really look at, it has to be really futuristic ideas which can, with a lot of confidence of course, which will help you to really grow the industry from where we are today to where we want it to be. And ZF plays a very critical role in it. What we manufacture transmissions, we manufacture shock absorbers, we manufacture clutches, and also chassis components. And what we are trying to do in each and every aspect of our business is to see how does the end customer gain from using a ZF product. If you look at a transmission or a clutch, we always talk about fuel efficiency improvement. And I see that if you look at the pie chart which was put in before, mm-hmm. if you look at the pie chart you put in before, you can very clearly see that 60% of the cost is coming from the fuel, and any reduction there will have the maximum impact for the OE supplier, for the final user of the vehicle. So it's very important for the supply chain to look at how can we really differentiate between the total cost, the cost of acquisition, and really look at the cost of ownership. It is right. The BS6 implementation is a classic example. While the industry started with a lot of hesitation, I think it's the whole industry has embraced this move from BS4 to BS6 as the need of the hour. We know that the cost is going to increase by a good margin from 1st of April 2020. But we all know that, you know, over a period of time, it is going to benefit us as a community, as a society, and also as a country. And I'm sure that it will also help each and every truck owner in this country, because we are talking about a driver comfort. Let us take, and many of us come from manufacturing, and some of you should understand this, is that there were times when the operators on the shop floor were not given their due. But we know very clearly a motivated employee makes a big difference in productivity. And there's a lot of discussion which happens as to how can we ensure that our employees are motivated and passionate about what they do at home. And that's exactly what we need to do about drivers. How are we looking at the drivers is just not, you know, for me, a good driver and with a very good comfort zone, I'm sure that he would like to drive the vehicle much more for a longer distance, which helps the fleet operator to get a lot of mileage, literally mileage, and also it also helps the life of the vehicle. Now, though I did come only in the afternoon, but another important part of this industry is the service technicians. And I think as we move up toward on the technology ladder, what we need to look at is how can the technicians be trained to maintain these vehicles, more so as to not to what to do, but what not to do with the vehicles, because now we are not talking about those mechanical components, we are talking about mechatronic or even electronic components. And hence, the component manufacturers play a very critical role, because if the inputs are those which help you to improve the efficiency and the effectiveness of the industry, then I'm sure that, you know, it half of the problem is taken care. And then when the people in the industry start using it and operating it well, I'm sure we will be having an industry which is really having those productivity at the highest norms. A couple of points which I would like to say is what ZF does is we are into the car industry. We are primarily in the passenger car industry. And what we do is we learn from the things which we implement in the passenger cars and then implement into the commercial vehicles space. We all know that, you know, with the Google Maps, with the AMTs we have in the cars, our own productivity has improved drastically. Today, and I think all of us are Indians here, we know we don't have to ask for where is this lane or where is this out, and because of which the vehicle does not stop. We don't have to slow down the vehicle because the Google map directly takes us to the point. Because of which our productivity is improved, our predictability of reaching to a location has improved drastically. Today, there has been instances, and I'm sure all of you will agree, 5 years back, 5 years back, that, you know, the truck has left Bombay or from the factory of my supplier and I still don't know when it will reach. Okay. The technology has moved so fast, so much further that, you know, we are able to really trace out the vehicle and say that it will come to your factory at such and such a time. And all these add up to the productivity of the industry and in turn, the efficiency of the fleet owner. Because today he can, I'm sure they will be able to predict as to this vehicle will reach this factory at such and such a time and I can book this vehicle back within so much time. Which and if you add up all these small droplets, we'll be able to directly see that, you know, there is a productivity improvement. So if you, what we say is components like steering linkages, which we manufacture, are maintenance-free joints, which means you remember the old buzzword, fill it, shut it, and forget it. And that's the sort of products we are talking about, where the vehicle doesn't have to stop and do the greasing or even do some maintenance part of it. So the downtime is reduced. The driver comfort is pushing the driver to drive long distances, which in turn improves the fuel efficiency. Our transmissions are such that we can guarantee you 2 to 3% improvement in fuel efficiency. So with all these new technologies, we are able to say that the fleet owners will see a difference in those trucks where the technologies are implemented. So that's how we would contribute, and how I wish the entire supply chain, though we do really talk about the total cost of ownership, but at the layman level or at the ground level, many a time we still fight the cost of acquisition versus the cost of ownership debate. That's what I would like to
Thanks,
say.
Thanks, Suresh. If I may come to Deepak. So you are, Vodafone is an international company and you have worked, I think, a lot on the industry globally in the logistics supply chain. Probably you have done a lot more in developed countries and you have started doing something maybe in countries like developing countries like India. So if you can broadly explain that, what is the ultimate scope for technology in terms of Internet of Things? Where do you see, in a very ambitious situation, where do you see the industry maybe 3 to 5 years down the line? What kind of technology adaptation you expect? And what kind of investment may be required to do this kind of technology adoption in our country?
Sure. I'll give it a shot. It's a big question. Our understanding of this industry, the telematics industry today, is it's worth about 1,000 crores in India today. But it's growing very rapidly. So in the next 3 years, it's expected to go to 2.5 times, maybe 2,500 crores. This industry, I think the fleet owners and this segment is exactly the kind of sort of segment that is very amenable to aggregation, right? Because it's completely fragmented. It's fragmented in terms of the number of people. It's fragmented in terms of the kind of technology people use and working methodologies and so on. So that's where it's headed. So it's headed. It's going at a very rapid growth rate of at least 25% CAGR. The industry, in our opinion, consists of three parts really. So one part is the hardware and all the other stuff, devices and all those other things that go into it. I'm including applications and. It's the general basic telematics stuff. There's some money to be made in installing it as well and maintaining it and all of that stuff. But the real growth in the future, we think, is going to come from services. So services today is about 30 to 35% of this industry, so about 300 crores out of 1,000 crores is coming from services. But that's where the real growth is going to come from in the future tomorrow. So services like, of course, simple services like analytics, you can. I mean, there's already some of that happening today. Everybody's talking about benefits. You can reduce, you can improve asset management, you can reduce fuel costs, you can do all of that stuff. But increasingly, we'll start seeing more sophisticated services. So services that fleet owners will require as a part of their ongoing operational processes. And I quite like the idea of loaded truck. I think that's potentially a service, right? And increasingly, we will see services like this coming up and content as well. Potentially tomorrow, I mean, the use case could well be that, and you guys are talking about driver comfort, for example, there could well be a way of monitoring driver comfort on an ongoing ride and finding a way of then, managing the parameters that influence that comfort while the driver is driving. But that's the kind of, that's the direction that we're heading towards. So we're heading really away from hardware, away from infrastructure, if I may say so, but really getting into a direction where services will make a big impact. And by the way, I do believe, I do not think India is a developing country in many of these aspects. I do believe we are pretty much at the cutting edge of whatever's happening around the world. Half the world wants to come here, by the way, because this is where the opportunity is. So I think we all, I mean, I can give you enough statistics of how other companies or logistics companies have used technology to gain operational efficiency and so on. But I do believe that given the mass and the size that India has and given the adoption of telematics in this country, I think we are pretty much in the top two or three countries in the world in terms of adoption and definitely very much on an accelerated path as far as the direction that we're going. So I'm quite positive about it.
That sounds great. So Pradeep, do you agree with Deepak what he said? And also, what are the challenges you see? Like he talked about the potential, but if you can highlight the challenges of adoption of technology, also in both in terms of maybe skilled manpower, availability of skilled manpower, and also in terms of the kind of investment that is required.
Right, okay. So first of all, thank you very much for being here. It's a great afternoon, and I really want to say thank you to ma'am for that matter. It's been quite inspiring. Thank you very much for that. More importantly, I'm coming from Reliance. The organization name is Unlimit, and we are a pure play IoT player. So from a technology standpoint, we believe that IoT will significantly make a huge difference for in every segment, and more importantly, in the transport and logistics segment. And transport and logistics segment obviously is not only the fleet part of the story, but obviously the other elements as well. You know, ships are obviously a huge amount of, they say that more than 90% of the world trade runs on the ships. But coming specifically onto the fleets, what we have today, one of the key verticals which we look very closely is the transport and logistics. And there, obviously, we work as cooperative competitors with Vodafone as well. So many of the things which Deepak mentioned, obviously, I'm forced to agree, or rather it's true for that matter. One of the elements which we see related to increase in terms of fortunes for the transportation companies or the fleet owners is in terms of using technology from a basic telematics part of the story, which I'm sure that most of the, even the smaller companies and the big companies today have. But we believe that the game is played much more better for the benefit of organizations like us and the fleet owner as well, is in terms of how the data which is going to come out of that one is to play into. Obviously, that's part of service as well. For example, data broking is going to be one of the biggest areas where both the parties, it will have the fleet owners getting benefited, the insurance players, for example, they're going to get benefited, the bankers are going to get benefited, the technology companies are going to get benefited on the whole thing. Because where you're going to actually measure how you're going to drive and how well you're going to drive. Okay. So there are products which are like, user-based insurance, which in India, which are getting through from an insurance standpoint. And look at the amount of data which comes in. That's going to make a significant difference in terms of you designing from the very start, from an OEM standpoint till the end of the value chain, in terms of improving anything and everything which we have been talking about here. Because today, many a times, we are talking on qualitative data points. And if we are in a position to have quantitative data points on the back of the hardware, which has got the sensors or the gateways, so on and so forth, the connectivity, and you have a seamless connectivity coming through, and you have the data available, if you are going to able to analyze that one and ensure that you're able to get predictability back onto the fleet owners to every single cog in the wheel, that's going to make a random change in terms of how we are looking at business even today. Now, coming to the point which has been asked about the amount of investment which has to go in, I believe that every single piece in the value chain, essentially, from a technology standpoint, would have an amount of cost reduction to come through. Today, if you look at, you know, starting from the very basic devices, what you keep, the telematics devices, what you have at the moment, they are all like 2G, 3G component modules which you have today. I'm sure that over a period of time, the amount of data requests which will come from all these ones are going to be significant. And obviously, you're expecting the modules to be looking better and better, to be more 4G compatible, so on and so forth. And obviously, the module prices have to come down, otherwise it won't work. Like the way we're talking about electric vehicles. With the battery prices are not coming down, there is no way the electric vehicle is going to cut ice in the industry. So we believe that every single element, there will be a cost reduction, because that's what is going to drive on the whole thing. There's a global study which talks about saying that in the next 15 years, if you want to, the way it is envisaged to go in. For example, there are three major changes which people talk about in the industry, the forces of change they call about. One is basically, you know, we are expected to have EVs driving in a big manner. I'm sure that that's not going to happen quickly in India, considering where we are today. But in 15 years, they expect to have 30% of the vehicles going to be in EV. I'm talking about the vehicles which are going to be on the road, which is including the commercial vehicles. The second behavior, what we see is that you're expecting to have self-driven ones coming in. And I'm sure that in many of the smart cities which we are talking about, we see that change going to happen. The commercial vehicle owners, which are going to do the you know, the CV part of the story, where they are going to do the logistics, they have to be mindful of this change coming through. And the third one is the urbanization part, which we see from a social standpoint, where in which more people are moving to cities. Now, these changes which are going to reinforce the whole thing. The study says that there's going to be $900 billion investment which has happened to happen in the next 15 years time. And India plus China, considering the 1/3 of the manpower what we have, you can expect that was the amount of investment which has to go in. I heard some great numbers around here. I'm sure that, you know, there are billions of dollars which is required from an investment standpoint to the infrastructure, to every single element in the value chain. We believe in Reliance Unlimited to ensure that how best we can help the transport and logistic industry by bringing in connectivity management capability, by bringing in device management behind it, how we can bring in analytics capabilities to ensure that we are able to predict so that your customers, your end customers, get what they demand and deserve.
Thanks a lot. Going back to Siddharth, so since you are dealing with a very large number of players and really at the ground level, so if you can give some granularity in terms of the kind of challenges that you see in terms of technology adoption, this space which you are talking about, 90% of the fleet operators before GST implementation were totally unorganized. Probably many of them are outside the tax net. Of course, now with GST, the tax angle has gone away. But still, there are a lot of other things like fuel monitoring for drivers was possibly not as tight as it can be with telematics today. Similarly, there are certain amount of money that you have to pay to traffic or toll centers. Some of it is not on paper. So the segment had been operating completely outside the organized limit in the past, and they're used to operating in a certain manner. The drivers are completely used to operating in a certain manner. So what challenges do you see? I know GST would have solved a lot of this significant part of the problems, but still a lot of the other problems still remain, because the ecosystem is not just fleet owners. It is the drivers, it is the traffic police, traffic cops, or other people who deal with them. So what are the challenges you see, and how do you see that getting addressed?
Okay, I'll probably put them in two parts. One, on the part of if we see a life of a fleet owner, which is driver come owners, there are many problems and solutions we have discussed. One of the solutions that we are trying to create, there's a lot that every OEM is doing, providing them services, on-site assistance. One of the areas which we see that even if technology or GST has come, which actually is a part of a pain point in their profitability, is the serious issue with loading and unloading scheduling in India. The asset idle because of improper planned or unscheduled loading and unloading in India does eat away 8% of the top line for any fleet owners in India. And we don't see that getting solved. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's not going to get solved in any time soon. That's one part which is a problem that we see is not getting solved. on the part of adoption of technology, I think there's a lot of work in terms of reducing the cost of data that Jio has done for India. I mean, at least we are thankful to them. It is because of that there is a mobile available now for 700 rupees, which has a prepaid rental in it, color screen, and it uses data, and it can do a WhatsApp and can use apps. Had it been 2.5 years back, it was a difficult scenario. Today, what we see, Subrata, there are drivers who do a WhatsApp video chat. They easily share their locations. They understand the usage of WhatsApp. They understand the usage of apps. We may think that, hey, the driver is not able to speak in English, but that does not mean he's not smart, right? Using a technology does not need you need to know a language, right? Their ability to use WhatsApp, and that's what I've seen in the span of last 8 or 9 months, is phenomenal. I mean, they understand WhatsApp chat, they understand video chat, they know when to do a video chat, they know when to do a video document, they would share the location, they know what is location sharing, right? So a bit of part of the problem, I think, if you would have asked this question to me 1.5 years back, there were a lot of problems. How is he going to use the technology? How is he going to afford it? The cost of smartphone was 6,000, 7,000 rupees, but I think, we are thankful to the capital deployed by Jio in the market that is paving way significantly. Trust me.
Yeah, I know that's investment by, that's one thing. I think another point is that a lot of PVC money also has come into the startup ecosystem.
Yes.
So today, a lot of capital is possibly not looking at return, immediate return. But when that capital also starts expecting some return, then a lot of this cost may start going up, be it the data cost, be it the cost of services that companies like you provide. All of this may start going up.
I will not go in much of details of our P&L or
no,
case, but
not
I
your
will,
company,
I'll come to
but
the point.
Then ecosystem.
That's just a general perception about ventures per se. I think we are of the few aggregators, which we are proud of, who actually have done profitable. Right? I know what I'm saying. So on the monthly operations of unit economics, we are of the few aggregators who actually have seen PAT positive records. That has happened, right? On the part of PE VC money, I think that's maybe we keep that off the debate because everyone would have a different view around it, right? There are good side and bad side of it. There is no clear thing which say it is good or something which says it bad. But yes, on the part which you said, yes, a lot of capital is available and a lot of changes that we have seen in terms of adoption of technology, and maybe if we say there are behavioral change in drivers or truck owners or we all users, which was to happen in 5 years, somebody has catalyzed that behavioral change by putting that capital to happen in 2 years. Yes, that somebody has significantly catalyzed it. So if that behavioral change was to happen in 7 years in drivers, if it has happened in 3 years, then the answer is yes, it has. Somebody has done it very smartly.
I just wanted to make a comment on the challenges that I think we face in the market. So while traditionally I think everyone tends to believe that it is the driver who would face the most challenge, I disagree a bit with that. I've seen drivers in Germany. I've seen drivers in UK. I think the point that Siddharth was making about can you use technology, it doesn't matter whether you can speak English or not, as long as you can speak the local language, it's fine. But if you can use technology and you adapt to it, I think that's the key thing. And I think we as a country and as a culture adapt to technology reasonably fast, especially if it's got anything to do with social media on it, right? So I don't think that's a challenge. I think the challenge that we face, one is the companies like us face, which is basically that there's a lack of standardization in the whole ecosystem. So there are devices coming onto the network, telematics devices. These are not standard devices. They go in and out of the network, and they So once we stabilize some of the standards, I think that will solve a lot of the problems that we face, and of course, as a result of which customers face. But I think the bigger problem is companies, which are small startup. I mean startup fleet owners. They're small companies who are. Who will need to use this technology to start making decisions. So the way they make decisions today and is going to be very different from the way they will need to make decisions tomorrow. And I think that is the fundamental challenge that people face in adopting to this technology. I mean, the lady before us was talking about how she makes a decision about if I have an extra truck here, what do I do with it? How do I use it? You know, the algorithms that you will build into some of this will change the way she's going to think about her decisions. And I think that's the fundamental barrier that we face in technology adoption. That's been my experience of working with small businesses around the world, where basically, unless you change your business decision-making processes, you will never be able to adopt technology. So that's how I think about it.
Yeah, Suresh, if we look at the vehicles, post BS6 in particular, I think there will be a lot of electronics coming to the vehicles. So I think that means two things. One, of course, all this telematics and other monitoring probably would become, would start generating a lot more data. And secondly, I think this spare market, this unorganized spare market, which is there, whatever little is available today on the roadside, that will disappear.
It's not little.
Yeah, so 30% or whatever. CM estimate is 30%. So I don't know if, ACMA estimate is 30%. So I don't know if it is 30% or whatever. So that will disappear. So now, one way to look at it is that the vehicle technology is getting better, so vehicle would have a longer life and more reliability, there will be less breakdown. But what about the cost? And the availability of service, because the unorganized players are also facilitating service at all kinds of locations and all kinds of hours.
So, an organization which is 100 years old like ZF, in the last 3 years we have been talking, our theme is see, think and act. What do you mean by see, think and act is we have gadgets which are the cameras which see, like for example the automatic parking, so the cameras, those are also in our product portfolio. Then we have the microprocessors with think, and then finally we have the products which are the mechanical ones which are manufactured to act based on these. So even the organizations are changing, like you talk about all these organizations like ZF, Conti, Bosch, all are moving up the value chain and saying that, you know, we cannot remain as a traditionally manufacturing organization. We have to change our space and we have to really start thinking about it. And that's exactly what the team talks about. Now, having said that, a lot of electronics will come into it. And if you really look at our service, in the last 2 years, we have also started moving towards e-commerce. The spares can be ordered over. We have committed that, you know, there will be the spare parts available at a doorstep, at the customer's doorstep in such and such a time. We are trying to monitor it. So all these telematics platforms are being used by us also, not only to compete with what is happening, but to stay upfront, to move ahead in the value chain and say that yes, amidst this competition, and to say that yes, if you use our product and you need our service, then you know you get it through the channels which are the modern channels which are available. Now, coming to the cost, again, I come back to the same thing. I feel and I strongly believe what he said is that if you look at the history of any new technology which has been launched, we know how the mobiles were launched a few decades back, and you know it was a very expensive, and then it came down, and then features got added, it went up, again it comes down. So any new technology, when it comes in, there will be an initial phase when at the launch there will be an increase in cost. But over a period of time, the customer demands, the industry demands that we need to make it more and more affordable. And especially in an Indian context where, you know, we really are people who look at the value of any cost addition which we do, the demand of reducing costs come in immediately. And I can tell you very clearly that, you know, in the last 2 years, the amount of cost reductions which we have done on the products which we have been manufacturing, I think it's phenomenal. So while I do accept that there would be some amount of increase in cost initially, but I feel that, you know, with the ecosystem which we have, be it in India or around, but more in India, I am sure that, you know, the cost will become affordable and value addition, and we will see more value than the cost which we get. So it will come for any new technology which comes in. That's my view.
Thanks. Now, Pradeep, if you can add something about the technology aspect, in the sense, I don't understand technology, but with so much of telematics and IoT, so is there a very standardized product available on the shelf? Like when a fleet owner or a transport operator has to make a decision in terms of adoption of technology. So what are the options available to him and how does he choose the right option? So I don't know what, the price could be different. You can get a cheaper product from, I don't know, from China, from all kinds of places. So how does one standardize those products and how does one ensure that you don't, the industry also needs, even players like you probably need some kind of standardized hardware. So how do you ensure that and how do you help the customers choose that?
I think it's a very pertinent question. You know, the challenge what we face is that we find competition in the market wherein which you have fundamentally the customer, here the fleet owners rather, essentially not too sure what they want. They have seen something. Yeah. They have told that, okay, there will be a telematics device. Great. Okay, what is it going to give you? Not too sure. Then the person who is meeting me or whoever the meeting them say that, okay, I'll give you all those things. I'll give you capabilities to track you, your vehicle. It can help you in terms of asset tracking, which is like the asset inside your vehicle as well. It will help you in terms of probably geofencing and ensuring that where the vehicle is parked for some time, it is crossing over the geofence which you're keeping, ensuring that you are notified behind the whole thing. A list of array of things is mentioned. I think it's very important first to sit with the customer to understand that in what is his business, basic business, and also to ensure, identify that, you know, what is the basic things he want to have it. For example, the requirements of DHL, you know, because the DHL was mentioned by our esteemed speaker before, the requirements of DHL would be very different from the requirements what you have from a, you know, a 203 sized, you know, player or a 50 sized player for that matter. Okay. So what we do is that we ensure that we first sit with the player to understand, make him appreciate that what are you trying to get out of the whole thing, first of all. Number two is that, you know, we find challenge where in which people start comparing just on the back of the price. Now, we know that if you want to have a basic product which is good enough, then it has to have a pay basic price for that one as well. But very interestingly mentioned about China, I'm not going to quote that one. But what happens is that we see a lot of products which comes in the market, which is maybe 1/10 of is a good product because the chipsets and water modules and things what you have on that one. And the customer would not really appreciate what does that mean. You know, I could probably say that if you have a chipset and or a module which is like of this capability with these specs what you have, because modules essentially has got now specifications fairly standardized for that matter, and then this will stay for you for the next 5 years for that matter, the customer sometimes doesn't even understand. He will look for probably like, you know, 500 rupees, 700 rupee device or 1,000 rupee device. Vis-a-vis, you may have a device which will help you in terms of tracking and all the things what you spoke about, possibly will stay for another 5 to 7 years for that matter. Okay, so we need to help in educating the team, the customer, in terms of appreciating what the customer really wants, number one, and ensure that what is the value he is going to get, because acquisition cost is one, but after that you are going to spend significant amount of money in terms of, you know, how you're going to upkeep the whole thing and sustain the stuff, because the device what you're going to use in telematics is in a very rugged environment, number one. It's going to be probably mistreated a bit for that matter. Rather abused as well. So, you know, I had a very interesting experience. I was talking to one of the big players who was shipping, you know, perishable items a bit. And he was saying that I want to have a device which has to be kept where the driver will not even understand it is there. Now, that's going to be very difficult. How am I going to keep it? And he was giving me and suggesting me, saying, can you keep it under the chair of the driver, where the seating seat where you're sitting, or, you know, you can keep it where he will never be able to find it. So we find very interesting, you know, sort of stuff which comes in. And there is a lot of pilferage which happens, how you can ensure that the petrol is not, diesel is essentially not used. So the listing of requirements as well as, you know, making the customer appreciate that what he really wants, is he going for a longer run or is he going for a quick fix, makes a huge difference in the whole game.
So is there a room for some kind of OPEX model? Our industry is looking at that?
Definitely the industry is looking towards a service-based model, which means that everyone in the industry is looking for an OPEX-based model. I mean, you can see that probably now the election time is coming up. There are a lot of requirements which people come back and say, in the next 3 months, I want to have my every single van to be tracked. And I want to make sure that, you know, after that, the device could be thrown off. I don't give a damn about it. Right? I'm sure that you got so many states currently available, and now it's a safe 7-phase election. You know, people want to use it, and the government is also driving for it. So OPEX model is the only way to go ahead in terms of things. And I'm sure that why OPEX model will be more interesting for the players also is that, you know, in the cash is always a bit difficult, capital is difficult to get, and if they are able to have a, you know, service as a SaaS model, rather the way we call in the telecom and the IT world, I think that is the model which will go in, and it's much more easy to provide that one at this point in time. We provide OPEX based solutions to the customers.
And do you agree with Deepak that we are in the cutting edge, or do you think India is still a little behind?
No, I think that India definitely is, I will not say that we are in the cutting edge of technology, but we are in the cutting edge of adoption. Our excitement in terms of adopting something is fantastic. And I'm sure that, you know, I was in Barcelona a couple of weeks back on the Mobile World Congress, and the amount of technology effort which has been put across by the global players in terms of ensuring that how the trucking and transportation and logistics, the supply chain management could be enhanced, is significantly high. So you can talk about that. You see only IoT and 5G, not talking 5G at the moment, but the amount of IoT which could be put into all the logistic elements and ensuring that how we can bring value on the whole stuff. And many a times the use cases are discussed on the back of India and China. Because if it can be successful in India, it can work anywhere for that matter, that's for sure. Okay, and the more importantly, Indians are more than happy to do test everything. So, you know, we are more than happy. I mean, the word jugaad itself comes from here, right? I mean, but leaving that one, we love to adopt technology. I mean, we love to try it out for that matter. And I think that I agree with Deepak with the fact that from the cutting edge adoption, we will never love to call ourselves anymore a developing nation. We are developed from a mindset standpoint in terms of taking things on board as quickly as possible and try it out and to give feedback to see that what more I want in the least cost available. That's very important. Okay, so that would be my view on it.
Yeah, Siddhartha, and if you can add some final words, because the larger players still make better profit, but smaller players often are hand to mouth. So any additional investment, I'm sure they understand the economics of the business extremely well. So you have to first convince them that technology is going to benefit them. So what kind of challenges do you see in that?
I think it's a very normal human thing. If you find a guy, say them that, hey, you're earning 100 rupees now, and if you use this, you're going to make 120 rupees, say, for example. And if he uses it and he find, hey, it was not 120, but I'm getting 115 at least. As far as I understand Indian market, if there is somebody who is making more money by usage of technology, that technology get adopted at the fastest possible rate in India than as compared to any other thing. May that be technology or anything, right? I mean, we have been talking about telematics. You asked about the OpEx-based solution, what if, because telematics have been in talk. We have been talking about basic FMS, advanced FMS, high-end FMS, then basic telematics, high-end telematics. And there had been costs attached to it, whether you do a OBD device installed in it when you sell a truck or you do an aftermarket fitment. But if you are able to convince that guy that, hey, if you use this device, and if you have a pilferage of 12 liters of diesel in one trip, and if you use this, you're going to save 200 liters of diesel in a year, he will immediately install it. I think it's not about that down cost. If you give value to him, and he is there's one thing with Indian part is that the business does not come in volumes. He will try you. He will test you. If it works, then the volumes are ready.
But one thing, tell me, like for the small truck operators, this fuel pilferage, actually in the past maybe that was getting adjusted with driver's salary, isn't it?
As you do the monitoring,
pilferage goes down, driver compensation has to go up.
Yes, but there's a mixed bag of it. We speak with fleet owners on and off daily. Few believe that it's in their habit. I mean, pardon me, I'm not complaining or putting a blame on somebody, but that's how a fleet owner thinks that even if I increase their salary to 30,000, it is bound to happen. It may be psychology. They think it like that even if I increase the salary. So I think there was Ajay and Vijay in the noontime, and Mr. Call brought up the point of, hey, why not put up an AC? And the other gentleman said that I will sleep, right? It's in their mind. I mean, you know, similarly, is in the mind of a transporter. He thinks that if I increase his salary, even then he is definitely going to steal. I mean, I think a good number of transporters still think like that. I think the better solution to is that, and which I said in starting, is that make that driver the entrepreneur, make them driver the owner of the asset, and give him the business when you sell the truck. That solves everything.
So I think maybe we can take up some questions from the audience.
You know, transporter having a fleet of 2-3 or whatever. Okay. See, this 2-3 has to be upgraded to the DHL model. Otherwise, we won't be doing justice to the model, to the era we are entering into.
Right.
So, what would be role of your companies like your organizations of your size or perhaps OEMs, us, Okay, because everything, otherwise they would be falling in business. They won't take off the way we would have wanted them. Forget the AC part, which you rightly picked up, but that's the need of our. It's not that DHL model is rocket science. That's also very basics. I mean, we would talk about advanced telematics. That's also telematics only. It's perhaps more sensors. Beyond theft, it will be tracking torque required on a certain route, and therefore the kind of truck I should buy, because the traction required in certain gradabilities is lesser, which telematics, advanced telematics perhaps throws them.
Yeah.
So I would specifically ask, or how much time do you think that it will take for those smaller relatively customers to reach to those things?
Okay, very interesting question. I mean, may not be the expert at this one, but I can give a sense. I think that, you know, there are two parts of this thing. One is that, as you rightly mentioned, there's a mindset change which is required in terms of, you know, the small player to start thinking that he want to play the big game at some point in time. Okay. Now, if you look at how that is going to happen, we need to ensure that the technology is going to the enabler in terms of doing it. Now, the enablement of technology happens in two ways. One is that the user actually starts feeling the benefit of that one, and then he starts and upgrading himself. The second element is that you are going to force this onto him. Okay. Now, that's a big role which the OEMs, essentially people from your side and people from our side, we play on the enabling part of the story. But I think that, you know, the OEMs and the tier one suppliers, for example, like the way you are for that matter, has a role to play to ensure that technology comes de facto into the whole stuff. Okay. Now, for example, if I take a few, I don't want to name the, some of the cars and the fleets or the stuff, some of the ports itself may not be open. You know, for example, if you want to say do fuel level monitoring. Yeah. Some of the ports itself in certain brands are not open because the OEM believes that, I'm not talking about Indian OEM, a foreign OEM, essentially don't want to have that control provider at any point in time. But it is very important to ensure that the OEMs in India, more importantly, when they're operating in India, force that technology drive into the whole thing. That's number one. And then we have a role in terms of ensuring that how we help in terms of enabling them, making them appreciate the value of technology. I'll give you a very interesting view. Wherein which, you know, I don't know how many people, maybe the industry people will know this one, something like the platooning, which I heard from, you know, one of the big players in the logistics side, you know, and they said that platooning and using IoT as an enabler to the whole thing makes a huge difference in terms of fuel, you know, savings. They say the front truck, which is on the platoon, essentially saves around 2.5% of the overall fuel benefit. And the rest of the trucks, if it is a 12 number, essentially has a 10 to 12% benefit on fuel. Okay. But how many people will appreciate that one? Maybe, I don't know, even the infrastructure in India, obviously with the golden quadrangle on around there, I think that we will be able to do it. But, you know, those kind of the learnings, which I'm sure that some of the people are trying it, and, you know, DHL in India, as we spoke about DHL, try to talk about and influence the players to form that kind of thing. So we need to play both the stuff in terms of ensuring there's a bit of a carrot as well as the stick. I don't want to say that, but yes, the enforcement would be a big enabler in terms of making sure. And I believe that in the next 5 years, we're going to see a rapid change in terms of how things are going to happen.
Therefore, a connected question. At the moment, Government of India introduced just about a few months back AIS 140. You would have heard of that. Just a black box, a GPS which enables you to let know where the vehicle is actually. So it's become mandatory. But it's about all of us put together, you know, influencing that and taking this basic level to something. Therefore, lot more engagement perhaps would be required with the government to make sure that at least some layers are built in quickly. You know, that's perhaps the goal.
Absolutely. So AIS 140, as you rightly mentioned, essentially, obviously, it was supposed to be in 2018 rollout, moved to April 2019 for that matter, essentially should have an emergency button with a dual profile behind it, not for EVs and auto rickshaws, what we have. I think that's a forced one which is coming in to ensure that there is some amount of, I will not call it basic tracking, but some amount of a capability already built into the things which are coming in. And I think a good amount of work is going behind it. But I should also mention that while the government had tried doing it effectively, maybe the different functions within the government essentially are not stitched up very well, which means that the effectiveness of rolling out AIS 140 within the timeline is still a bit of a questionable one.
I had a question for our esteemed panelists, so feel free to chip in. We have already heard, and it's a no-brainer, that there are three levels of telematics solutions out there. The very basic ones, and there we have probably a medium-priced one and a very high-priced one. And the larger fleet operators are probably at a liberty to implement them as and when capex and opex allow them. My question being that when you see the entire fleet's ecosystem, what do you kind of see the typical types of such solutions being used? So within all those price bands, so there we have a Rivigo kind of an in-house solution. We have some third-party solutions also out there, and maybe we also have some solutions that are being developed by the OEMs and inbuilt into the vehicles themselves. So if we are kind of want to do a pie chart out there, what kind of proportions would be there? Very roughly, I mean, numbers might be pretty difficult to get at here.
I think this is the third time I'm seeing you asking the same question to understand the penetration of telematics in India. To be very honest with you, to the max I know about telematics and its penetration, as far as advanced telematics is considered, that is primarily used by large fleet owners in India, which constitute, when I say large, I'm putting a tag of people who own more than 300 trucks. That penetration is even less than 2% today, which is in the large size fleet. And I'm talking about advanced telematics. When we go to basic telematics, in basic, there are people who count GPS trackers as well, and there are people who do not. In case of Indian market, you would have to count the GPS tracking as well included in the basic FMS or basic telematics, because that's how we are, that's how we have fleet in India. That proportion should be around 4.3-4.4%. When I'm saying that data, that is includes entire CV. That includes SCV as well. If you are to understand only in HCV, I think maybe Mr. Call would have the better exact data for that. Not definitely us. Does that answer your question? Okay, thank you.
I think in the construction equipment space, some OEMs are putting advanced telematics in almost all the equipment. But those are very OEM specific.
I'm Vaikam Kumar from JM Financial. Mr. Siddharth had referred to the challenges faced by the small and medium fleet operators. Just want to understand if this is a more recent phenomenon caused by the regulatory changes, or this has been the case for the last decade or so. And what would be the share of small and medium fleet operators in the country's overall fleet base?
You're talking about the challenge of idle asset? Yeah, I think it's there for a long time. And your question number two was, what is the proportion of the fleet they own? See, the definition of small and medium-sized fleet owners vary with the interpretation of data. So an organization like Tata Motors would classify people owning less than 15 trucks as small and medium-sized fleet owners. In case of European market, the definition stands still 50 truck ownership, actually. If you have to take a, there's no, I'm not sure that there is any organization who has exact data of it. If there would be anybody, it would be Tata Motors, because they have the entire stream of it. My rough estimate is 74%.
So my question is, you mentioned that you have kind of program or product to guarantee about 2-3% fuel economy from the transmission or driveline alone. So where do you see the role of lubricant here?
I will not be able to tell you very specifically, but definitely you see, the one of the critical factors with which the transmissions, or you talk about any of the steering linkages, is the lubrication part of it. Okay, the level of now, how does the lubricant support us is by saying that, you know, the now there are two ways of looking at it. Is it the initial cost or is it the reliability factor? Okay, let us take a step back and talk about the machines which you use on the shop floor. Mm-hmm. When you are able to say that, you know, any lubricant can stay for X number of hours or X number of days or X number of months, depending upon the time of usage. And in similar lines, so many kilometers of support which you can do without a replacement. Yeah. That's exactly what finally a person like a fleet owner who will look at. Okay. So the reliability of the lubricant to help us to improve the maintainability of the transmission or the entire powertrain is very critical. So when we talk about transmissions, improving transmissions, we also are in touch with organizations like you, where we say that how can we say that we are able to give the OEM an assurance that the reliability of our product is much higher. And that's where we come in and say, we recommend these oils to be used. And that we can see with any car manufacturer or a truck manufacturer.
Yeah, that is from assurance on reliability. My question was contribution on fuel economy.
On the fuel economy again, you see, it's not a direct link. It's not a direct link. But if you have an efficient drivetrain with very minimal wear and tear, where we are talking about, and that's exactly what the lubricant space comes in. So can I say that, you know, if I use a better lubricant, I can get out of the 3%, half a percent comes from lubricant? It's very difficult. It's not a really a cause and effect sort of a thing. But I can only say that it plays a significant part, but it's on an indirect methodology. And that's where, when it comes to filling in oil, we always recommend, and to many of the OEMs, we always give our transmissions with our oils, because that's what it's all our recommendation is. So I may not be able to really tell you that, you know, it's exactly this percentage or this much is what effect of lubricant would be, but I can only say we really work very much with the lubricant suppliers to improve the performance of the entire powertrain.
Definitely, I think
even on the dampers, our dampers also are ones where you use lubricants of the highest level, so we use them.
Mr. Siddharth, in terms of benefit, whenever we see, you know, there's a fuel efficiency possible from different technologies. I presented about 2% of fuel economy kind of possible from technology perspective. Where do you see this benefit, sitting in the entire gamut? Because there was some challenges we hear that, you know, that becomes part of cell D, then pilferage, those things. And then we are talking about sensors putting, you know, into the tank to monitor whether it is really, properly tracked. So in that entire gamut, where do you see any such kind of advancement are really beneficial to the fleet owner, or does it really goes into the same way that fixed route, fixed mileage is given, or fixed diesel is given to drivers, and then gets really appreciated by fleet operators?
From the current context, I think what you are saying is a
reality.
Somewhere realistic scenario is that a little portion of the benefit goes back to the owner.
Yeah.
May that be owner of 2 trucks or 3 trucks, that's the basic reality.
Yeah.
On the part of your second question, which is whether we see it improving,
yeah.
I think yes. Of lately we have seen that there is a sizable behavioral change, primarily on the aspects that you see the regulations around the financing and defaulting has become very strict in India. Gone are the days, so you know what used to happen maybe 3-4 years back, if a vehicle is financed by Tata Finance or Shriram Finance and somebody has missed 1 or 2 EMIs, it was considered part of parcel of the business.
Mm-hmm.
1 EMI missed, you don't catch hold of that guy. Today, if you miss that, it becomes a significant problem for you to do business even way forward, because the way the regulations is able to catch hold of you and how you're able to become a default in system in everywhere in banking system has made the fleet owner, even with who owns 2 or 3 trucks, very vigilant, because that attitude of being careless, not concerned, I think it's slowly fading away. They are getting serious about making money. They want to make money, and if there are avenues where they can catch hold of save any money by stopping pilferage or using technology, I think they are serious and they are monitoring it.
Yeah, Ashish from Suvals MSX International. My question pertains to the use of technology. Technology generates a lot of data. I have myself experienced, and I have been talking to one of the EV vehicle manufacturer. He said, today there are about 200 parameters that my vehicle can generate. I am only capturing 20, and God knows how many I am actually analyzing. Soon this is going to be 2000. So what comes out is like this data, and Indian probably mentality is that, you know, unable the data analysis is not in ASEAN. We probably prefer Sidhi Baat. So do you think that this inability to analyze data which is generated is also hampering the absorption of a technology-led products which generates a lot of data?
See, the amount of data which comes in, you're absolutely spot on the EV side. I'll take a car case as well as a quick one. Roughly around 36 parameters are easily available from car and all the ports which are available for that matter. Now, all these 36 will not be of any interest to one person. Let's be very clear about it. You know, some of the data, at least around, we understand that from an OEM who is going to use that one for the OEM sale as well as the aftermarket, roughly around 14 to 15 parameters are good enough. The rest of the ones are essentially, for multiple other users. Sometimes it's for preventive maintenance of some reason, something for the users, like maybe fleet owners, individual owners, so on and so forth. There is a challenge in terms of, from the user's understanding of what this is required for. That is our fundamental challenge as a technology player who wants to enable the country or the people for that matter. When we go back, people come back and say that we require some, I made this point before as well in a different tone. It's basically like we want to be very clear in terms of what is required, because the amount of data which is coming out from these vehicles are significantly very high. Now, and how you are going to analyze this data, how you are going to make meaningful output of the whole thing, either you are going to use it on some rule-based analytics or you are going to use some predictive capabilities on top of that one to give some meaningful information which will help in decision-making for the people. But all that theory is fine if the customer clearly understands what he needs for that matter. If the customer is not too sure what he wants for that stuff, and he starts getting into saying that I want to get all these data parameters and give me all the analytics behind it, it is not going to help him in any form or shape, because it is going to be a huge overload of data coming to him, and that's what we face many times, because it is something like the Google doctor.
But most cases, I think customers will not know what data he needs. I think
the customer knows.
Technology provider has to tell them.
Customer has to know that what is the end result he wants for that matter.
Yeah.
Okay. We can help them in terms of, as I initially mentioned, he should be knowing that, okay, I want to have a fuel to be monitored. Fine, great. We know that where you can do that one. Or we want to know that I want the asset to be monitored. Mm. Or I want to know that whether the driver is actually sleeping.
Yeah.
Or I want to know that whether the car which is coming or the vehicle coming behind for that matter is able to see through my vehicle. Okay. Mm. You got solutions for all those things available. You can have cameras, you can have huge dashboards like the way the Samsung does at this point in time. You can have the full camera behind your truck itself so that the behind truck can actually see through the whole thing. So all those possibilities are available. He should be very clear. We can help in terms of making him appreciate these are the trends in the market. These are the things which we can provide. This will help you to do with this kind of an ROI behind it. But then if the customer also believes that I want to get everything, and then I think that he is go up for a bit of a trouble, because he will get a lot of data which will be sort of like in bit of a rough language like a junk to him, and will not help in terms of doing it. And we struggle in a big way because it all adds into the cost. Data processing is not cheap, and even if after data processing, data analytics and ensuring that it is presented in a manner which makes sense doesn't come cheap even now at this point in time.
Deepak, you would like to?
Sure. A connected car, just a factoid, a connected car generates 4 terabytes of data every day. So that's a lot of data, right? And the question you asked is about, can OEMs use the data? Well, I do believe OEMs have the capability to use the data. Do they want to use the data? I'm sure there are a lot of OEMs here, and I'm sure you guys understand that better. But the other aspect of data, by the way, is that this is just data being generated from one source. Now, the moment you create a platform and you start adding data from other sources, if I start adding content, for example, social media data, and I start creating a different value equation for the end user, there could be use cases. So we'll have to create the use cases for the end customer. That's what Subrata was saying as well. And rather than just depending on the customer's requirement for the data, basic sensor data is very basic. There are a bunch of 10 things you can measure, and that's about it. But the real value of data is going far beyond and creating data sets from other unique sets as well. So I think that's the future. I think that's where we want to head towards. And I can assure you the end customer will find it very useful.
My question is for Mr. Siddharth. Since this logistics is a highly credit-driven market, so how you plan to address this issue? We have seen success in passenger aggregation in terms of Ola, Uber, Redbus, where the journey, either the payment is made in advance in case of Redbus, or Ola and Uber, the payment is made immediate. But in logistics, it's highly credit-driven market. So, and the present system, the present cycle takes care of this credit. So when you plan, either you plan to disrupt the existing system, so how you address this credit-driven issue?
I will answer that in two parts. One, what is the current scenario? I think you're absolutely right. Yes, that the credit scenario exists. How we have solved it so far is that since the area we ply in is more towards SME and MSME, and we primarily serve the on-spot booking, We do not deal in the contract rate space. The larger utility of credits in India, which is a 15-month, 1-month, 45-days payment cycles, are in contract rate space. Whereas in your on-spot booking, which is utilized by SME and MSME, there is a combination of advance and to-pay freight payment conditions where we operate. This is where we operate. Second part of your question, having said that, yes, that does exist as a part of the ecosystem in India. In future, I think, you see, one of the areas whenever credit comes into picture, whether shipper is bearing that credit cost, financing cost, or there's an intermediary who's bearing that financing cost, let's say it is 2% a month and the evit cycle comes at 45 days, at the end of it, if the freight prices are getting reduced by 10-15%, then people are able to bear that cost and make the advance payment.
Thank you.
That does happen.
Okay, I think so. Time is up. So thanks everybody for all the questions, and thanks all the panelists for the insights.